Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. Over in 1 John chapter 4, John said that, he said, "Beloved, believe not every spirit." He said, "But try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world." There's a lot of people that will tell you all kinds of things, try to guide you in a certain way, try to make you believe a certain thing. Some will shed crocodile tears. Others will just become very bold and forceful and all. But what John said is, I want you to try the spirits. And notice that it's not a capital S spirit. It's the spirit that comes upon. It's the spirit of man. It's the spirit in which things are done. And I have to tell you, my experience has been that not everyone is genuinely sincere when they deal with one another or when they deal with God. And so going on in 1 John 4, down in verse 6, the Bible said, "We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error." And so I want to preach a little to this subject here as it relates to this, and especially as it relates to Psalm 51, that we are to try the spirits. Try the spirits. Now, clearly, David had found himself up to his eyeballs in sin, and he got caught. Not only was he caught, but he was pointed out. He was publicly made known. Nathan the prophet pointed his finger in his face and said, "Thou art the man." And so it was well known what he had done. It wasn't one of those secret sins that no one knew of. There were plenty that knew about it. Joab knew exactly the murderous spirit that David had in trying to wipe out Uriah. So, and I have to think that even Bathsheba knew David's intentions were not all that honorable. So the whole thing, as far as David's behavior is concerned, it stinks. And so one would try to imagine if a man like that had his back up against the wall and had to respond in such a way to, we'll say, make things right. We have to try the spirit of this man to see whether or not he is genuinely sincere. And I believe that there are some things here that David speaks of that kind of reveal where he's coming from. And the first thing that we see is having a right spirit. A right spirit. Down in verse number 10, David said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Clearly indicating that uncleanness in our lives, a defiled heart, a wicked heart, wicked imaginations, cannot, a person with that condition in their lives cannot have a right spirit. Will not have a right spirit with God, will not have a right spirit with others, whether vertically or horizontally. And so it's for that reason that he recognized, if I'm going to have a right spirit, God, you have to clean up my heart. And when you clean up my heart, then I can say and expect a renewed or a right spirit in me. Let me ask you this question tonight. Are things right with you? Do you have a right spirit? Again, this is not really referring to, this is not talking about whether or not you're saved. I'm not talking about whether or not you're saved. I'm not talking about whether or not the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, is residing inside of you. I'm talking about whether or not you have a right spirit. Is your spirit right? And if it's not right, then chances are there's something wrong. There's something unclean. There's some sin, besetting or not. Maybe it's a one-time thing, but whatever it is, Isaiah 59 and verse 2 said, but your iniquities have separated you and your God. You can't have a right spirit with God if you have sin in your life. Your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. And so the question we need to ask ourselves, remember, this is David trying to make things right with God. Man looketh on the outward appearance. We all do. God looks on the heart. God is going to try the spirit. We're told to try the spirit as well. Now, that's not judging people's motives or anything like that, but it is taking what they're saying, taking what they're doing, and really seeing if there's a genuine sincerity behind it. Because some people, I can tell you with all certainty, I go to the jail, there's a lot of sad people down there. But they're not necessarily sad because of the sin they've committed. They're sad because they got caught. They're sad because somebody like Nathan said, thou art the man. And they know it. I've got a guy that was in the jail, and he's told me right straight out. He said, there's no point of me arguing this thing, fighting this thing. They got me. He knows it. And so many people want to get a lawyer and, you know, try to find some little loophole to go through. But you know just as well as I do whether or not God's got you. Whether or not you've been back up against the wall and there's no way to dodge this thing. There's no way to come out from under it. There's no way to make this thing put a positive spin on it. So what do? Well, you acknowledge it. And that's exactly what David did here in Psalm 51. He recognizes that what he has done is wrong. It's sinful. God, it's against you. It has harmed my spirit. I don't have a right spirit anymore. And when you don't have a right spirit, everything's affected by it. The way you interact with God, the interest that you have for church, the interest that you have for reading his word, for prayer, for anything of a spiritual nature, if your spirit's not right, you're not going to do what you ought to do. And you know, and God wants to, I think of this, I think of how Adam and Eve must have waited on God before the serpent showed up. How they must have waited on God when God came down in the cool of the day to just kind of walk around in the garden with them. And they're probably sitting there waiting on God. They enjoyed that. They enjoyed having it. But after they sinned, what's Adam doing? He's running and hiding. He doesn't have a right spirit anymore. He doesn't want to be with God. He's afraid of God. God went looking for him anyway, didn't he? Jesus said in Matthew 5 and verse number 6, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. God expects that when our spirit is not right, that we will hunger and thirst to make it right. Are things right between you and God tonight? Are things right between you and your spouse? Are things right between you and your parents or your grandparents? Are things right with brothers and sisters in the Lord? That's the question we need to ask. Do you have a right spirit? Again, going back to Matthew 5 and verse 23 and 24, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and thou rememberest that thy brother has aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way, first be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. James 4 and verse 8 says, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. A right spirit. Try the spirits. Not necessarily try somebody else's spirit. Howbeit, you could certainly do that if someone is saying or doing something and you're supposed to respond to that, then I guess you have a responsibility to try the spirits there. But we ought to try our own spirit. Acknowledge ourselves. We're the ones that have to look in the mirror every day and determine whether or not we're right with God. We're right with one another. And so we have the first one that David speaks of here is a right spirit. The second one is a holy spirit. He says in verse number 11, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Now, I'm not going to get into all of the theological implications of what this verse actually entails, because if you look closely, you will see here in the text that that Spirit, that Holy Spirit, is not capitalized. Now, I'll be the first one to say to you, doctrinally speaking, in the Old Testament, God could take His Spirit from you. And regardless of what people want to say and think about this subject matter, not only did the Holy Spirit of God come upon people, but He also indwelt them. And as He indwelt them, he could be removed from them, lickety-split, at God's own wishes here. And so I'm not saying that it could not relate to that, because David was in danger of losing the Spirit of God in his life. But it says, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. I think there's something to be said about having a Holy Spirit, a desire, if you will, because that's what our spirit really is a desire. He's a spirited character. To have a spirit that is holy. In other words, desiring that which is right and good and pure. He said, don't allow this Holy Spirit to be taken from me. Now, obviously, we know that in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit himself cannot leave us, will not leave us. The Bible says that in Ephesians 1 and verse 13, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Again, in Ephesians 4 and verse 30, the Bible says that we're not to grieve. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed until the day of redemption. But in John 14, verse 16 and 17, Jesus said, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. However, we can lose, and that's really the point I'm trying to make here. Even though we can't lose the Holy Spirit of God from our lives because we're sealed by him, he indwells with us forever until the day of redemption. We can lose because we leak. We can spiritually lose our power with God. We can lose that filling that the Holy Spirit of God gives us. That's why we're told to be filled, Ephesians 5:18. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, he said, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, clearly there's a spirit to being drunk. People get drunken with all kinds of spirit. The spirit of booze, the spirit of drugs, the spirit of entertainment, the spirit of fun times, even the spirit of work. People get all wrapped up in that. God said, don't be drunk with that spirit. Don't allow another spirit to guide and direct you. He said, you be filled with the Spirit of Christ. Matter of fact, the Bible said that the fruit of the Spirit, in other words, what it produces is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Ephesians 3 and verse 17 and 19, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. See, God wants us to be filled. He wants us to have this Holy Spirit about us. And just seems to me like of late in modern Christianity, a holy existence doesn't seem to be all that popular. A spirit of activity, that seems to be desired, but a Holy Spirit, it's like, oh, you think you're so good. Well, since when has good become bad? Matter of fact, God pronounces a woe. Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. try the spirits. Try the spirits. That's what David is talking about here in this text. He says, restore in me, renew in me a right spirit. We have to have a right spirit. And we ought to have a holy spirit. And then he also says in verse number 12, he said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit. A free spirit. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, now the Lord is that spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Free. Folks, we are free. We are free today to do right. Not the opposite. Our liberty, our freedom is based, the free spirit that we have is the free spirit to do right, to worship God, to honor Him, not to do whatever we please. 1 Peter 2 and verse 15 and 16. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. We're free to serve God. Romans 8, verse 15, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. John 8, 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Make you free. Galatians 5, 1 says, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. As I said, we're free to do right. We're free to live right. We're free to speak right. We're free to live right. We're free to cry. Again, Galatians 5 and verse 22 and 23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. See, we're free. We're free to do all of those things. We're free to live just as holy as we can, live just as honestly as we can, just as openly. Our lives ought to be an open book. That's why I sometimes wonder about individuals that are so concerned about their freedoms that they're, you know, I think of that preacher down in wherever he is, Arizona or whatever. Where's he from? The guy that is so upset about getting stopped at checkpoints. Yeah, I know who he is. I just didn't want to use his name. Is it Arizona? I know it's down in that area down there. But he's offended by the fact that they stop him and they want him to, you know, either, I don't know, show him what's in the trunk or whatever. Hey, if we're doing right and we're free to do right, I'm not in position by any of those things. Doesn't faze me at all. Only people that have something to hide are worried about those things. Now, if they're barging into your house in the middle of the night and wanting to search the place, then I say, well, that's different. But if you're just driving along and somebody says, hey, show me your license. I'm not going to play the game, you know, I don't submit to searches. It's like, what crazy kind of attitude is this? If I'm law enforcement and I get that kind of answer, I want to put you on the ground. I think you're up to no good. Should that be our free spirit? I don't think so. I don't think so. Try the spirits. David is looking at his life here. He recognizes, he sees some things. He sees that we need a right spirit. He sees that we ought to have a holy spirit. He recognizes a free spirit. But then he also notices this one in verse 17. He says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. a broken spirit. You know, if you're looking at the sincerity of someone, I guess you have to see whether or not they have a broken spirit. That's the key. I mean, the others are almost the results. You know, having a right spirit, having a Holy Spirit and a free spirit. But if those things have been taken from you, if those things are in jeopardy, then the only way to tell whether or not a person is sincere about getting them back, if they feel as though they've lost them, is do they genuinely have a broken spirit? If they can just flip it off like, you know, take it or leave it, then I don't think they have a broken spirit. I don't think they're overly concerned about it. And when sin rises up in our lives, and when we're not doing what we ought to do, and it's pointed out to us, we ought to have a broken spirit. If we feel as though that our spirit is not right, and it's not holy, and it's not free, then we ought to be broken about it. And I think that's what finally did it for God. Because that's what it says. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. You know, back in Judges 7 and verse 16 to 20, let me read this and give you kind of an illustration of this. It says, and he divided the 300 men into three companies, and he put a trumpet in every man's hand with empty pitchers and lamps within the pitchers. And he said to them, look on me and do likewise. And behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall ye do. When I blow with a trumpet, I and all that are with me, then blow ye the trumpets also on every side of all the camp, and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp in the beginning of the middle watch, and they had but newly set the watch, and they blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers that were in their hands. And the three companies blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers and held the lamps in their left hands and the trumpets in their right hands to blow withal. And they cried, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. See, the pitcher is a vessel. They broke the vessels. They broke the pitchers. And the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 4 that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel. This vessel, right here, should know how to possess his vessel. How? In sanctification and in honor. 2 Timothy 2, verse 20 and 21. But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor, unfortunately, some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. And so we have a responsibility to purge ourselves of things that are not right so that we can be a vessel unto honor. How are you going to do that if you're not willing to be broken? In Mark 14 and verse 3, the Bible says, and being in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, speaking of Jesus, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious, and she broke the box and poured it on his head. She broke the box. It was expensive. It was precious. It was valuable to her, and yet she valued him more and was willing to break the box. God's looking for some broken vessels. He's looking for somebody that's willing to be broken for his cause. Broken vessels, broken spirits, broken the spirit of pride, the spirit of covetousness, the spirit of anger and jealousy and bitterness. In Proverbs 18 and verse 14, the Bible says that the spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity, but a wounded spirit who can bear? No one wants to stay broken. As a matter of fact, if you're broken, you want to be fixed, or at least you ought to want to be fixed. Proverbs 15:13 says, a merry heart maketh a cheerful countenance, but by sorrow of the heart, the spirit is broken. The spirit's broken when the heart is affected. You hear about that sometimes, where sometimes you just have to say, you know, you got to break this spirit. just going to break their spirit. See, God uses broken things, broken soil in order to produce a crop, broken clouds in order to give rain, broken grain in order to give bread, broken bread in order to give strength, a broken Savior in order to save mankind. Try the spirits. Try the spirits. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. You can tell, I believe, and unless someone is the greatest actor in the world, you can tell whether or not a person is genuinely sincere. You can. And eventually it'll show anyway. But when a person begins to acknowledge their sin, you know, nobody wants to air their dirty laundry. But when a person said, you know what, I'm wrong, I've done this or I've not done that, and it's ever before me, and we acknowledge it, that it's before God, and we want to make it right, it's going to affect our spirit. We need to have, we ought to have, every one of us tonight needs to have a right spirit. A right spirit. And I'm not saying just a right spirit is not simply going around and laughing and being giddy all day. By having a right spirit. Wanting to do, see, the key there is right. Is it right? Are you doing right? If you're not doing right, then you don't have a right spirit. David said he recognized that, and because of it, he said, I need that spirit righted. Renew a right spirit. He knew it was right to have a right spirit, and he knew he didn't have it. And then not only that, he also understood what a Holy Spirit was. When you just desire things of God, when you want a spiritual relationship with God, when you, as was mentioned this morning, when you want to walk with God like Enoch, when you desire that, when you want to be among God's people, when you want to be in the Word of God, when you want to be in communion with God, then you know you've got a Holy Spirit. And then have a free spirit. To know that we're free to choose how we're going to conduct ourselves. And we choose to live right and do right. We make that decision. No one's making us do it. We do that with children. We make them do right. At some point in their life, they're left to themselves. What we've trained them up to do is what they're responsible to do. They have to take the action themselves. They're free to do their own thing. We put an age on it. We say, okay, you're 18 now. You're free. Isn't it unfortunate that you could force a child, a young person, a teenager, you could force them to do spiritual things until they're 18. But then when they're 18, you have to back away and say, okay, it's now your decision. And we hear time and time again, we'll say, well, they don't want to anymore. They don't want to anymore? I guess they never had it to begin with. Yeah. Right? That's not a free spirit. That's a spirit of bondage. Not many people are living in the spirit of bondage, doing what they do because they feel as though they're forced to have to do it. No, I want to. And if those things are not real to us, if we don't sense that we have that, what? A right spirit, a Holy Spirit, a free spirit, then that ought to break us. That ought to sadden us and break us.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast. An outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, fundamental